This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Sports Files is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Tonight, we'll be talking about college football, of course. So what did you do last Saturday? I certainly hope you relaxed and enjoyed yourself, because if you're like a lot of other folks in this area, this coming Saturday is spoken for. A grand Southern ritual is back. The Swallows have returned to Capistrano, and they're wearing helmets and cleats. Fire up the laptop and look at the college football schedule, and you'll see those magic words, this week's games. This week's games! How great is that? And thanks to the insatiable demands of television, this week's games start Thursday night at the Liberty Bowl, where the University of Memphis will host Mississippi State. The Memphis advertising campaign says, join the revolution. We'll see how it plays out. Will it be more like the American colonies circa 1776, or more like Hungary circa 1956? Then Saturday in Knoxville, Tennessee hosts Montana in year two of Derek Dooley's reign. We know Tennessee doesn't have an athletic director. We'll see if the Vols have a football team. But the most telling game of the weekend might be the one in Oxford, where Ole Miss will play BYU. Former MUS star Barry Brunetti will start at quarterback for the Rebels. So yes, there's a lot to talk about, and we've assembled a crack panel for the task. Last week, we previewed high school football. Next week, we'll take a look at the NFL. But tonight, we'll talk college football, coming up next. As promised, joined now by my panel, a couple of them are familiar, Chris Vernon from 730 Fox Sports, and Rob Fisher, who's been here before from Sports 56. And then our third panelist is Romero Miller, former Ole Miss quarterback, who's now a pharmaceutical salesman, having eschewed the life of a football coach because it's too hard work. You said off the air. Let me start with all of you. It has been a tumultuous summer in college football. What do you, Romero, make of it? So let's start with you.
Well, I think it's just something that's probably been going on for a while. But now there's so much media out right now that if anything happened, you can tweet it or you can get on Facebook and you can find out anything. And I guess it's more investigative reporters who are doing a job for the NCAA than what they're actually doing.
So you think, for example, what's happening at Miami, strippers, payments, all that, when you read that story, there was nothing surprising in it to you?
It was surprising to me. It was just so big. But you hear individual stories at different schools, and I've been hearing it for a while, and I'm quite sure if I've been hearing it, I'm quite sure some other guys been hearing it also. You know, earlier I was just telling you, I just think the problem is going to get worse before it get better. You know, just because now there's a price tag out.
Explain that. Kids out there. How's that work?
Well, you know, I think we've always heard stories of players getting paid. But now we know Miami player were getting 60, 40, 30, whatever thousand. So now you got kids coming through. Now they're hearing it. And they're going to start thinking that, you know what, maybe I should be getting this amount of money. And trust me, they're going to start asking. So what are the schools going to do? You know, we'll see.
Chris, what do you make of it?
It's fatiguing as a college football fan, you know, because it's been going on. It's like every week throughout the entire summer.
And yeah. Big ones. We got North Carolina, which is supposed to be, you know, above it all. Right. You've got Ohio State, the biggest of the big. You've got USC, the biggest of the big. Yep. You've got the U, which is no longer as big. But this is
Oregon. I mean, I think what it makes me think is Auburn. Is it possible to win at an extremely high level with, quote, doing the right thing? And seemingly this summer has taught us it's impossible.
Well, I was talking to a Tennessee booster last week who is essentially disgusted with Derek Dooley because he says, listen, he's trying to do it the right way. But we all fish from the same sewer.
Right.
And if you're not willing to fish from the sewer and keep the players who need to be kept, you're not going to be able to compete with Auburn and Alabama and LSU. And essentially he said, yeah, this is admirable. It's great. But enough of that. I want W's.
It's absurd. I mean, Chris is right. I don't think you can win big-time college football now without cheating. I mean, by deduction, Arkansas may be the national champion from last year, and they didn't even win their bowl game after losing to Ohio State. It's a big problem, and we're all outraged, but nothing's going to happen. I mean, some players might be ineligible. Some wins might be taken away. But the risk is so far outweighs the – I mean, the reward outweighs the risk. But it's not even close
that you have to do it.
I mean, you go on probation for a couple of years, USC is going to be fine in 5 years. Ohio State in 5 years is going to be winning national championships. Oregon, what happened to that whole Oregon situation, the Willie Lyles deal? Nothing has happened. What's going to happen in Miami? It's going to go away. And like Romaro said, I mean, if the NCAA can't do their job, and it's Yahoo that's taking the NCAA to find things out.
The NCAA doesn't really want to do their job.
No,
why
would
they? It's
probably
inconvenient for them.
It makes their sport look
good. Yahoo is doing what they're doing, and that I think the worst thing that's happened into college football, from the perspective of the people who run college football, is that people are peeling back because they just assume it not. That's why they have a staff of eight or whatever as opposed to a staff of 88.
You talk about paying players, and, you know, that always makes me laugh because you always talk about these kids need pizza. They need pizza. They need to be able to take their girlfriend out to dinner. They don't want pizza. They don't want to go out to dinner. They
want
cars.
Jordan Jefferson just had 50 pairs of shoes.
Terrell Pryor had 8 cars in the time that he was at Ohio State. They want cars. They want jewelry. They want tattoos. If we pay every player $60,000 a year, sure, maybe we can work with that. But a couple $100 here and there, that's nothing. That's where the cheating will start.
What are the players? I mean, Romero wasn't so long ago that you were there. What do they think of it? I mean, do they laugh? Do they think, and how much is it out there? I mean, did you have pizza money? Did you have enough money to buy pizza?
Well, you know, I think I survived because I came from a family where I had a mom and a dad. And my mom and my dad, they was there for me. If I called them, I needed anything, you know, they would give it to me. But, you know, you have a lot of kids coming through now that, you know, a single-parent home, and their mom and their dad they don't have it like that where they can just help them out. So if you got a booster or whoever that's going to walk up and give somebody $200 to $300, trust me, that kid is not going to turn that money down. Now, whether it come back and bite him in the tail, you know, who knows.
Well, you made the point off the air about Terrell Pryor, that although there was the car stuff, he basically got in the He got in trouble for tattoos and jerseys.
Yep. You know, and just to me, just something about that, you know, it's his jersey. The school sell helmets and stuff like that at the end of the year. But if a player go and sell it, you know, he gets suspended 5 games. You know, being a player, you know, I've been in a situation where I know I've probably done some things like that. But, you know, I just know it's just hard. It's going to be hard on guys.
Who wouldn't sell someone, if someone comes up to you and says, I'll give you $1,000 for your helmet, or $500, $200 for a jersey. Who, what college kid wouldn't do that?
Yep.
Well, I think one rule needs to change in college athletics, and that's allowing scholarship athletes to work. And if that means a booster wants to pay a kid $20,000 to deliver his paper every day, I don't care. It takes the school out of it. You're now not cheating. Now the schools and the NCAA, they can focus on one thing, and that's making sure the kids go to class, the kids are eligible. If a kid's out partying with Evan Shapiro every single night, as long as he's at class at 8 a.m. and he's passing and we raise the GPA to 2.5 and he's eligible to play football, what's the problem? Who's hurt?
Well, I mean, that would pretty much open up the gigantic Pandora's box ever. If the best quarterback in the nation is going to go to a school and next year he's the CEO of some company making $1 million
a year. FedEx would pay you $1 million, but Kentucky Fried Chicken could pay you $2 million to go to Louisville.
But are they going to pay that much money for athletes? No, it would be the same problem you have today.
They pay $200,000 when it's illegal.
Right.
I mean, literally, if you believe the Logan Young thing, and it was proven in court, Albert Means got $200,000 when he wasn't allowed to do anything. If FedEx was allowed, I mean, I'm not saying FedEx would necessarily. Let's leave FedEx
smarter
out of it.
Than that, though. He's but not going to come out and pay
Romero
hundreds
would
of thousands
pay
of dollars.
Millions of dollars for a quarterback to go to Ole Miss at this point.
I think it would actually help that problem. I don't think they would pay as much as they're paying now because now it is legal. Now you pay a guy to come in as a freshman. You know, $50,000, Cam Newton's instance, you pay him, you know, $200,000, whatever it's going to be, to come to Auburn. Well, when he's a sophomore, you don't have to give him any more money. What's he going to do, transfer? Or what's he going to do, sit out a year to go somewhere else? Let's make him graduate.
It would be hard. Let's talk actual football here for a moment. Chris, Have you joined the revolution?
Yeah, I think I've pretty much joined the revolution. listen, it's not going to be easy.
The revolution, of course, is Larry Porter's revitalization of the Memphis football.
Listen, I made no bones about it. And in fact, when you did your column a couple weeks ago, I said I'm rooting for the guy. He's got to get a couple of wins, or else he's got to have a problem on his hands, because all of the sudden, all of this hard work, all of these recruits that he signed up, because make no mistake, the guy is on track to bring in the greatest recruiting class in the history of Memphis football. Now, it's all relative. I mean, this would not be the greatest class for many
others.
Worst
course, right. Yeah,
it would be the best for Memphis. But the guy's got to win some games. He's got to win some games for the guys that's on his roster to get them some confidence in believing in him. And more importantly, he's got to win some games so that those guys stay committed. But in the case that he does, I mean, I think the guy's going to bring some talent on. I don't know. He's got to win more than three games. I mean, he can't be winning, you know.
You, Romero, you're around this. Obviously, you're an Ole Miss quarterback, but you're around Memphis a lot. What do you think of the Memphis football program?
Well, I think Larry Porter, when he came in, the one thing about him was everybody said that he was a recruiter. And as you can see, as Chris was saying earlier, that he definitely got players on board to come. But also, you got to get some wins to keep those guys bought in, because some of those guys that he has committed right now, some of the bigger schools are going to try to come in and take, especially if the season goes south. So this is an important year, because like Chris said, he got to get the guys that's there to believe in him, and also he got to keep the guys in the boat.
Now, we're talking off the air. You were considering going to the game Thursday night, Memphis against Mississippi State, but I gather there's one big reason you are not going to go. It involves a certain ringing noise.
Well, I can't go. Being an Ole Miss guy, the last thing I want to do is see Mississippi State win a game.
Memphis was going to win that game, if the good Lord told you in advance, I got a small tip for you, Romero. Memphis is winning this one.
I'm there in a heartbeat. I'm there in a heartbeat, but I just can't take going there and listen to the Cowboys ring for three and a half, four quarters.
Rob, what's a good night, Thursday night, look like from the Memphis perspective?
Aggressive defense, make a couple of plays defensively, score some points, lose by 14 instead of 27, which is the spread for the game. I don't know if it's going to happen, but, you know, I was there last year in Starkville, and it was just a disaster from the open. Now, Larry Porter knows his team a little bit better. Somehow he's getting guys to believe in themselves. He's getting guys to believe in the program, and I mean, a lot of credit to him for that. You know, it's about effort. You want to see improvement. I don't know how many wins you're going to get, but you want to see effort defensively. You want to see better tackling. You want to see some sort of semblance of an offense. You know, this is second year in a row now. It's a new offense.
There was no offense last year and no defense. And they were giving up 40, 50 points a game and scoring 14. It was embarrassing.
And frankly, you want better decisions from Larry Porter this year, too. I mean, there were a lot of questionable decisions last year in a horrible season that, you know, you hope he grows in his second year as well. I think it's going to be an interesting year, because it's his players are going to play. They're going to be young. And it's his second year as the guy calling the shot.
Do you get a sense, though, that, you know, Chris Vernon may have joined the revolution. but I don't think a lot of people there's the media buzz about the recruiting has changed or in the program. But I don't get the sense, and I'll ask you,
I've got like one step on the revolution.
You got the flag, barricade.
He gets to two wins in the first like four or five games, I may like take the second step. Come on, man. Don't throw me like right in the – I ain't
Braveheart here. You're like standing in front of – you're the one guy in front
of
the tank.
I'm not leading the charge
in Beijing.
It.
You're that guy standing –
Listen, I'm hopeful that they're going to have good players go to – I mean, listen, I see these guys performing on Friday nights and he's got coming to Memphis. They're good players,
my
man.
My point is, though, I don't think the populace has joined.
Of course they haven't. Why would they? They won one game, man.
An embarrassing crowd there Thursday night.
No, they'll be all Mississippi State fans.
Exactly. Okay. So moving on, Ole Miss. You're our expert. Give me the Ole Miss prognosis.
Well, right now it's just so hard for me to say. You know, I like to say I think we can win 4 to 8 games. It's somewhere in between there. The reason I say that, we're going in, and I have no idea what we're getting out of the quarterback. If it turned out to be a debacle, we'll win four. If he played better than what to be expected, we possibly could win eight.
When you say you don't know what you're going to get out of the quarterback, you're a little scared. Nothing against him as an individual, but you're not convinced at this
point. I'm scared. I'm really scared. Preseason camp, we had three guys fighting for the position, and, you know, one day Bernetti will look great. The next 2 days, he'll disappear. The next day, Mackey will look great, and he'll disappear. I just didn't see the consistency that you're going to need to play in the SEC. So I'm hoping that when the lights come on, I'm hoping that somebody just picks it up and just take off. But, you know, we'll see come Saturday.
Rob?
When you have three guys and the coaching staff isn't sure which one's the best guy, I don't think it's because all three are great. I think it's because we got to pick one that might help us the best this year. Now, they have some talented wide receivers, but the problem is they're young. And Houston Nutt likes Zach Stout a lot because he's a terrific thrower.
He can sling it.
But he knows that his receivers are so young, so he doesn't know if that's the way to win football games. You go with Barry Brunetti, he can at least buy you some time, and he can, you know, move around the pocket a little bit, and they're certainly going to run the ball a lot like they always do. I think it's tough that you're starting with BYU. You don't have an opening game where you can feel like you can work things in and get your offense going, see what you have, really, because I don't know if you know what you have.
You win it. You win it, and we'll turn to Chris. You win that game against BYU, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden, everyone believes. I mean, it's a chance. That is a chance to get people on board quickly.
I agree with that. I like Brunetti a lot at MUS. Obviously, he had this season at West Virginia. I never saw him. And I haven't seen him down at Ole Miss in the spring or anything. But I liked him a lot in high school and thought he's the kind of guy. Listen, I think probably a BYU game, which will be the first game, they'll probably run the ball 45 times. And then if he throws, you know, 15 times, fine.
Roll him out a little bit.
Right? Roll him out. Keep the play going. If you got fast receivers, he was the kind of guy that I felt was dangerous, because you never want to play against guys that can make a play when everything breaks down. And as long as you got fast guys on the edges, he may make some plays.
Do a Houston Nutt impression for me. Do you have a Houston Nutt impression?
No.
You don't do one? No? So you're the only one who can do one. Can you do one for me?
When I sat in Barry Brunetti's living room, I told him, I said, Barry, I want to see you on that Jumbotron. I want to see the mamas and the daddies. Those are our MVPs, the grandmothers at Ole Miss, and they look up and they look at that Jumbotron and they say, "That's my boy." That's my boy.
Makes you just want to play for him. Doesn't it?
I tell you what I like about this year's team, Jeff. They're fast
and hungry.
Do you think Romeo is he in trouble if he loses? If he loses to Mississippi State, your beloved Mississippi State Bulldogs again, is he in trouble?
I think this BYU game is probably the biggest game that he's probably had in his coaching career. If they lose that game, the fans going to jump on him, and it's going to go downhill in a hurry. If you win that game, you start off 1-0. You got Southern Illinois and Vanderbilt. You possibly could be looking at 3-0. But if they come out against BYU, then that game come out to be on the wrong. If we come out on the wrong end,
right,
it could be a tailspin.
What's reasonable at Ole Miss?
You know, right now with this year's team, considering all the players that we've lost the last couple years on last year's team, I guess the fan will be excited with 6. I want 7, but yeah, I mean, I don't. We'll see it somewhere
else. All right, turn our attention to Tennessee. Is Derek Dooley gonna? Is it gonna work?
What do you mean by work? They're not gonna win the SEC East this year.
No, not this year. Is the Derek Dooley? Is he gonna be the coach here in 5 years?
I don't think so. And my reason is, you know, they were so young last year, and they're going to be very young this year. I mean, 80% of their starters are freshmen and sophomores. Now, my question to everybody who follows Tennessee closely is, all right, they're so young, and they finished last year strong against a very weak schedule at the end of the year. But in 2 years, when these freshmen and sophomores are juniors and seniors, are they going to be contending for the SEC East? And to a man, they say, well, probably not that good. Well, then how far are you going to go? And if this is your future, these freshmen and sophomores, and beating up on bad teams at the end of last year, how much better are you this year? 2 years from now, with this young group, if you're not competing for the SEC East, well, then what's your next step? And I think it'll be good to get them away from trouble and away from all the off-field drama that they had for the last handful of years. Get to some bowl games, get some good wins, maybe have a couple signature wins here and there. But I don't see them winning the SEC East under Derek Dooley, no.
He'll be fired after next year.
Wow.
He will. He'll get fired after next year.
You have
no, it won't be any good this year. It won't be any good next year. And then they're going to get rid of him. And his AD's gone. The guy that, the only guy that, like, believed in Derek Dooley.
Is gone.
He's gone. No other AD
funny, though.
On earth.
Derek Dooley's very funny.
Huh?
He's very funny.
He's funny?
He is funny.
In a very dry, not funny sort of way.
I don't know. I guess he's funny. Then maybe he can go do stand-up comedy. He'll get fired after next year. Listen, they're not going to be any good this year or next year. And like I said, the guy who was his boss is gone.
I would say the one thing that could change that is if Taylor Bray is, you can be mediocre, and if you have a difference maker at quarterback, and right now the SEC
is fairly thin on quarterback.
He was horrible in the spring game. He was horrible in the spring game.
And he was great against really bad teams.
And he was great against really bad teams at the end of the year. You're not a believer in Taylor Bray?
No, I'm just saying he was great against this last year.
Easy to be great against bad teams. It's easy to be great against bad teams.
I'll tell you, I was secondary last year. I mean, he looked like he won the Heisman Trophy last year. But as y'all were saying, you know, playing against a bad secondary.
Fired.
And his name's Tyler Bray.
Tyler. Did I not say Tyler?
Taylor
I said Taylor?
He's not any good either.
No, they're all bad. So is Tennessee, what's the hope for Tennessee? I mean, you believe that that the Fulmer thing was a huge mistake.
Huge mistake.
And so what's the way out? Now for Tennessee.
Fire him.
No, but then what?
Hire Dan Mullen. I mean, if you want answers, I'll give you answers.
All right, we got a little bit of time for Mississippi State. As a Ole Miss guy, does Dan Mullen get on your nerves?
Yes, a whole lot. But, you know, he's doing the right thing at Mississippi State. He got the entire fan base bought in. He got the players bought in. I mean, right now they're together. And the reason they're together because of Dan.
Well, so I think Dan Mullen's got everybody – their expectations out of control for Mississippi State after what they did last year. And you might want to temper it a little bit because I think this team's going to struggle even to make a bowl game this year. He gets to a bowl game this year, I think he bolts because he can't do better than what he did a year ago.
And Tennessee has got to do what Alabama did. They've got the money. But go out there and spend the money and get the best coach.
Who was that guy,
buy.
Though? But now it might be Dan Mullen. But Dan Mullen, even Dan Mullen, as successful as he's been, is not Nick Saban.
Right.
Fine, go get Nick Saban. But you can't yell, go get, who is the next Nick Saban?
If you're throwing around $5 million,
Michigan went out
anybody.
And got a guy no one had ever heard of.
If you've got $5 million, you can get anybody you want, I promise you.
Gus Malzahn.
All right, who's going to, I got 30 seconds. Yep. Who's going to win the national championship? Rob?
Arkansas.
Arkansas?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's ridiculous. Alabama wins the national championship. Yes.
Why? They need a quarterback. First,
because they got 50 NFL players on their team. How about that,
Romero? You're the expert here.
I want to stay in the SEC, but for some reason, I just feel like this may be Oklahoma year. If you look at it, you know the only schools they really play is Texas and maybe Florida State.
All right, Arkansas,
Alabama,
Oklahoma. All right, I'll be back with a wrap after one question.
I certainly hope so. I think that the new coach has done a fine job and a lot of hype going on, but I think that he will prevail. At least we hope he will prevail.
Well, unfortunately, I think that Mississippi State probably win the game. I mean, being that bigger conference, better conference, probably a better team. They've been coming along the last couple of years. I think they'll win it. I wish Memphis would, but I think Mississippi State will.
Well, of course Memphis is going to win. They've got a new lease on life. They've got great players. They've got a good battle going on at quarterback. And I think they've got the real intensity this year to get started off on the right foot and win that game.
Mississippi State's going to win Thursday night. We have a young coach. We have a lot of momentum. Have some stadium renovations coming. Have a lot of starter to turn on offense, turning quarterback. And we're excited about this football season. We think we're now got another 9 or 10 win season. And we're just ready to go. Go Dawgs!
Memphis going to win because we Memphis and we should win this year. We've let Mississippi State win the last couple of years and Memphis should get that win in.
I'll be honest with you about college football. Sometimes I hate the game. oh, not the games themselves, not the stadiums full of pageantry. I absolutely love all that. But the other stuff, the money squandered on stadiums, the $5 million contracts for coaches, the utter hypocrisy of it all. At its worst, college football is about recruiting kids who have no business being in college, justifying the decision to not pay them by calling them amateurs, but all the while throwing billions at facilities and coaches which have nothing, I repeat, nothing to do with the academic enterprise. It's an indefensible system. We're the only country in the world to do it this way. We attach professional sports teams to our universities and wonder why it sometimes doesn't work out. So what's a college football fan to do? Simple. Enjoy the Saturdays. Enjoy the time with your friends. That's what it's all about, after all. That's what draws us back every year. Yes, there are ugly scandals at Miami and Ohio State and North Carolina and on. But come Saturday, when millions come together to watch the games, they won't be thinking of any of that. They'll be laughing, having fun. They'll be talking with each other, building bonds. What are the chances that Ole Miss is going to win the SEC title this year? Pretty darn slim. But what are the chances that memories will be forged in the Grove? 100%. So I say enjoy the Grove, and before that, Tiger Lane. College football may be broken, but college football fans are okay by me. And that's it for Sports Files this week. You can always email the show at sportsfiles@wkno.org. To watch the show online, go to wkno.org and click on KNO Tonight. Next week, we'll be talking to former Redskins quarterback Joe Theismann. Until then, enjoy the games.